audience and what you said about the audience and the loop gets me back to something I wanted to see if other people wanted to respond to, which is this word aesthetics. It's like, I always forget what that word means. It's like one of those words I'm like always looking up, but I don't forget what anesthetic means, like when you go
under, and so they want to numb you, they want to take all your feeling away, right?
So I say, okay, so aesthetic is the opposite of that. It's bringing all the feeling back, and then, so then I think about aesthetics, and then these two, with the two of you, just said, makes me think about, well, whose aesthetics, whose feelings, who's all the senses?
Your mother gave us such an experience of being in the audience, and it looked like that was true in the atmosphere, but I don't know that I wasn't
one of them. So who is getting to really be part of that, have all their feelings engaged, and how do we know? And then there were a couple phrases I heard about aesthetics, like at one point, I think you said, protect, you said things where you need to protect aesthetics. I wonder what you meant, and how you understand aesthetics, that you're protecting them, and you brought up aesthetics of democracy, which seemed, I just wondered what other people, if that was at all an interesting thought as far as, I mean, I love the last question that's, I'm one of those people who didn't hear it, but that's not why I write things down. Really. I liked the question Andy asked us about how will this shape the future of American theater. I would really love some of you to say where you see the local going and what's the relationship to aesthetics.
Well, I actually find really interesting about that in terms of those protecting aesthetics and who exactly is taking this. It's becoming a big conversation in the whole Schumacher department. My roommate is an electronic music producer and it's kind of an electro right now. Is for artists do not release any information about themselves, the artists, they simply release the cover art, they drop the music, they put it out there, and then they share what are called stems, which is like a base file of whatever music they're making with other artists to remix and to release them together. And so I sort of begin to wonder, at least in theater, what really is the value in all of this, you know, marketing and communications and performance and having everyone know who you are all the time, rather than simply just releasing your work and then allowing other people to get the sound of that. I think for my own little theater company, that's the direction I would like to take that in. Because the less people know about me, the more they can actually focus on my art, which is both the invitation and the aesthetic. And that's just another thing I want to worry about.
You know what's really complex? I mean, I so hear you, I feel like I wish the world. You have to put people's bios in the program by the email. You have to, somebody, like, the way that the Foundry has been identified with me, apart from whatever it is that I've done to identify it, right? I have a partner who runs the family with me. His name's RJ McCulley, he's from Social Justice Board. We are partners, we are co-leaders of this company. We've been this way for a while. I did this as we tried this before with two others. Nobody would let it be ours. Everybody wanted it to be. They wanted it to be mine. When I don't put my bio in the program, funders come up to me, people come up to me and say, you need to do that.
Well, that's why it is so complex, because as a functioning company or whatever, it's like you have to communicate yourselves in this totally splintered way. So it's like, to funders, hell yes, you have to completely like over-identify yourself. And then they want to know exactly who you are. And then, you know, if it's a foundation, you have to learn to speak, you know, in tongues, basically, about yourself and cater to certain things. And I think that's, back to sort of protecting the aesthetics, be very careful to not do whatever mission drift or, you know, like, just sort of always try to remain in check about what your real passion and mission is, deep down, the purity of the pure or the stem or, you know, because it's really hard, because you're basically just, you know, spinning in circles, constantly trying to get money or getting people to see, so like back to marketing, it's like, if we're in this situation now with one of ours, Dan Fish, who's coming up in our season, March, and anyone who's more of a fan of sort of unconventional ideas about things, and it's been really wonderful. He's kind of broken down a lot of our systems, and like in terms of press and marketing, and inviting reviewers or not inviting reviewers, and how he, you know, even things like the performance schedules totally disturb, and it's like all these things because we've been doing it for years. I'm like, what, you know, like, no, this is how we do it, and then I'm like, oh, okay, and it just takes somebody like that sometimes. It's so important to kind of just like strip down and be like, here, sure, do like, start your show at 10 a.m. and whatever.
Also, you know, I think it's a really awesome idea too, but I'm thinking about, a lot of times I feel like, particularly in the Black community, which is where I come from, I run a company called Black Fest, and there's a lot of conversation about diluted identity, just connected to aesthetic, and I feel like there's a lot of catching up to do in some particular demographics when it comes to theater making, and particularly I think the Black community that is has always been expansive and global, but there's been one narrative that's been supported and encouraged, and so I feel that that's what's been. I think it's Humanity, which you wrote earlier, the Africa, Zimbabwe, and Botswana, and how she feels like she's sort of being, you know, put into a Black category. And so, like, for me, it's about first identifying the multi-layers within the Black experience, or the sort of African experience, because I feel like those people want to be identified because of, for so long, the filter and the POV has been someone else's POV. Even when it comes to Black Americans writing African stories, that's still not a particular, you know, indigenous narrative. So I just wanted to say I think that's a really great idea, but I feel like for some demographics, there's some catching up.
It's just I agree, except that it just gets commodified so quickly.
But it's commodification is like the step beyond the categorization. Because I think that Michael and I are experiencing that with our work is that people continually want to call us a community-based company or labels that talk about, and then it gets into these funky hierarchies of like, well, it's not really artistically sound, it's a community arts project, and these weird graphs, like the work doesn't stand on its own, it's more about our casting as opposed to the piece itself, or why aren't they connected, and it's, regardless, I think that it overlaps with what you're saying about, it's a process of categorization, and it's a process of saying, this is that, and this is that box that exists in that world. This is a Black experience that's over here, and so that as an artist, I think you lose the power of your work when you are told how to A, sell it, and B, what it is, and you're not allowed the experience of being a multiple of things.
And I mean, I want to draw that back to what Jan was saying, sort of, it's just that about the future of the theater, and this is about artists owning that role and narrative and not being a power of institutions. And what Daniel was talking about, and what I mean, I think, you know, that for too long institutions, you know, and it's not anybody's fault, but, you know, institutions are, because they're physical, because they have a certain amount of infrastructure, then become aggregators of capital and then allocators of that capital to make it work. And artists acquiring institutions previously to get the money to make the work and to get the cultural capital and application. And I think what we're realizing is that, you know, I think what Keith was sort of talking about sort of from the side is that artists actually have much more when they work with each other when they make work from specific. They are aware of complexity and the nuances and are working to solve these problems. And what you're describing, what Melody describes, when you come into the institution that has very marketing moving tickets framework, but not simplify and modify the other things that they modify you, you know, they modify the artist's work, but the artist doesn't see any income on the back end. So what this really is, I think what it feels like and what Sam was talking about electronic musicians and the way, you know, it's like, well, I may put a sample out of a certain bass track, but my name moves with it as other people use it and that builds the audience. So it's like, I think part of it is about artists taking control in their communities, in their networks, over the narrative, over the language, over the ownership of the intellectual property and content that they
Because the thing is, even if you don't have to sell it, you still have to talk about it, right? Even if you got a huge grant and like funded work for a year or something, you would actually still probably have to talk about your work, actually, in some way. And so it's up to us to come up with the language.
Sorry, just really quick. I just want to, I agree with everything you said, and I want to push back on it for a second, because I think it's not just artists who are always the people fighting the system. It's that, like, to achieve success in this field, there's a longevity that it takes to really make it as a career in the arts. It requires every artist and company to institutionalize themselves in some way, to find their own shorthand, which, and the shorthand by definition is the thing that we're always fighting against. We're trying to reopen those, anything, which we start fighting, when the show's back, with it. CalArts, which is like expected to be this basket of experimentation, but like when I tried to do a process that was slightly different, I met resistance from every corner, and I overcame it, and it was very valuable as an experience to fight in that institutional setting, but it's remarkable the shorthand that they use, you know, to achieve what they have on budget. And so like, I think that it's also from, and I'm not saying you're going to disagree with me at all, but like, from within, I think we also need to constantly challenge our own. I mean, it also for me comes back to the difference between marketing language and talking to funders and talking to foundations whose job it is, or they see it, to support work that is going to work, you know, and to support people that can succeed by some measure. And that language really changes based on. You have to, there's always a retroactive support. You know, they're always looking backwards at what's already working, trying to keep replicating that when we're trying to do the opposite of this intention.
But when you talk about the artist resting control versus an institution, I think the question is what institution, what context? Because you also were talking about money and how does the artist get paid to be an artist? And I just think it's important. Well, I see it happening that there are many platforms that there are increasingly more, many as me being an optimist, there are increasingly more platforms that artists are working out of, being able to create work that is true to a vision that they have, but that is kind of, it's decentralized. It doesn't all happen in cultural institutions like this. Again, it's not either or, this is one kind of place that art can happen. The fact is, and listen, I'll be the first to dish the dirt about higher ed with anybody. I can dish the dirt about higher ed as good as anyone I've ever met. On the other hand, I've seen amazing projects come out of higher ed because often colleges and universities, which are very diverse, they're publics and they're privates, they're big and they're small, they're in Wyoming and New York and Florida and, you know, you name it, and what they're doing in those places often is very interesting. And very interested in experimentation, and sometimes it's one of the best places to take your work further. Plus, it's a financial source, you know, and neighborhoods. There's a great project, some of you here are probably involved in it, in New York City called Naturally Occurring Cultural Districts. And it's really bringing support for what art brings in neighborhoods. And it doesn't mean you stop doing what you care about. It means you are part of the neighborhood. So there are other platforms which are not strictly cultural institute, and to me that's one of the places I hope the American theater is going as the capital A, capital T American theater.
I think you're right. I mean, the key to me, the thing that really set off all this networking, you know, and it feels to me like, I mean, one of the things is that it feels to me like all artists distinguish between money. You know, well, this is this kind of money, this some kind of money is better than other money. And I think, like, when you look at the Astor Gates, one of the best things that the Astor Gates has done is said, fuck that, money's money. And he doesn't care where it comes from as long as he gets what he wants to do. And I think that artists, you know, when I talk, it's like institutions are good for one thing, like the public theater is really good at some things, you know, CUNY and it's really good, you know, and the work that Imagine America is putting art in the university setting, all stuff. Like, all of these things exist. The thing is, how do we help build an ecosystem where the small, our individual artists and artists are able to navigate that, empower each other,
have agency.
That's our greatest pleasure, that we all get to enjoy every flavor of, you know, theater and all of every manifestation, you know, and shaping dignity and
faculty members, assure them that the students will be protected because it's the spirit, you know? So this happens in so many ways around our community. The unknown is at once terrifying, but actually the essence of what art is. So we constantly fight this battle between institutions and creativity.
Can I pull the room just to see how many people here feel responsible for inviting people to come to their work or to the work of people who curate? Can you raise your hand if you feel like you're responsible for inviting? Thanks. I just need a time. Thanks. I mean,
yeah. I just want to, I'm sort of just tagging on to the current pulse. Part of what I do with the New Black Fest is, one, sort of reclaim the large black narrative and sort of provide both with development and funding arts the opportunity to sort of rethink their own sort of POV and filter. And then what's important for me is that I try to share it with other theater companies to help build their respect and also educational quotient around particularly the African diaspora narrative. And so what I usually do is like, you know, I have like six plays I want to support in whatever way, and I'll reach out maybe to, you know, Rattlesnake Theater Company or our primary stages or whoever it is and see if they're open to like having a day workshop or sort of supporting a play right in 3 days or whatever that is. And that's my way of trying to not keep the aesthetic insular, but to help all of us sort of understand each other in a more enlightened way. And I'm finding that to be very, very successful just around just sort of marketing. Because when a theater company like your theater company has, you know, developed something that I sort of share with you, and then your folks want to come and see whatever else I'm doing or likewise come and see what you're doing. So it just builds this community with so that's, I think, a way to think about sharing is important and how open are we to that, really. And if it isn't part of your mission or your sort of aesthetic mission, then you know what happens then, even though it's important to sort of be introduced to new narratives and ways of talking about that.
I was attracted to this conversation because of the questions that we should have heard from the director of development at all over here. So I come from at this music event, an aggregator of capital, as you're saying, never not. And the conversation that we're having here today makes me feel reaffirms some concerns about this interregional theater and the way it's going and how we do in regional theater, is rarely created from within our community. You know, we bring great playwriting, we bring great directing, we bring great performers in, and our only, in that setting, our only way to make our community feel, to help our community feel connected to the work is by creating some contrived artificial connections to those people through things like bios and through things like interviews and through things like, you know, trying to give people some understanding of what they're going to see, which inevitably gets down to labeling or modifying or improving, because people, you know, we are not by and large performing for a community audience. We are performing for a community that is both permanent and and that they need something to grab onto. And so where is the intersection between what those people need to grab onto? You know, we can't fault them for what they don't know or don't think. So where's the intersection, I guess? When work is being, it's not loaded off the back of the truck. We pride ourselves on doing everything from, you know, from scratch. But it's not of the community in any of the ways that most people are talking about, and yet it's a difference.
I mean, it seems there's some really interesting ways that regional theaters are becoming more creating, including some work in their seasons that's more rooted where they're living. And I know South Coast Rec was doing something in their new work season with, they brought in playwrights to do residencies, and each was mentoring something that looked at the diversity in that county, right? And I know there was La Jolla Playhouse launched a Without Walls Festival, which is this one site-specific, so sometimes by playing with plays in the community, that's a way in. And, but it seems like, I think one thing, I think the network of ensemble theater is having a real influence in the regional theaters now. Like if, correct me if I'm wrong, I think there's like some 200 theater companies that are part of NET, and there's some 500 that are part of PCG, and there's a big overlap. I think like 100 of them are the same companies, and I'm told that even 15 years ago, maybe 5 would have been. So there's less either or. So I think it's the networking that Andy was talking about, that people just quite naturally, because of their interests, you know, you wouldn't have to call it community-based anymore. I think we're post community-based in a lot of ways, because you could be community-based, and you could be a regional leader, and you could be on something. Yeah. And then for another show, you might not be any of those things. I think there's more fluidity, and I see more and more regional theaters entering that one way or another.
All these institutions are at a certain level of maturity and a certain level of size, right? The distance between having an idea and executing an idea gets wider and wider and wider. More and more sets that you have to go through, and so there's a lot of dipping the toe in the water, but it makes you try to make sure.
But maybe it's also recognizing that your institution can't and shouldn't have to do it all.
Right.
And who is within your larger community and partner with, you know, to build.
I think what Eric is doing with the libraries is fantastic.
Absolutely.
I mean, he's doing some amazing stuff.
Yeah, we are.
What is
your Eric Chang?
I'm aware, but I don't know about the program.
It's a program that we actually focus on. I was on the phone on that one call with you, and I
actually
We wanted to create a partnership with the community public library, which is a private branch of the city of New Haven, and we got a small grant to work on a couple projects in there. First and easiest thing we did was we put a micro branch of the library in the lobby for each play. So each play had a collection of books that people could like hand and check out with the library card and they could return it in the state. And then also, at all the branches have theater passes that you can check out at the library, just like you check out a book. And then you call and the team member takes us that night. It's great. And the community ambassador program, which we've been, you know, inviting, you know, representatives from groups that are underrepresented at theater to come and, you know, attend their dress rehearsal and get involved with. And then they invite people. You know, and it's all great.
Takes time.
It's all great, but it takes time. And actually, when what you're saying before about the marketing thing and how you speak to people, it impacts and develops, and sometimes it's made by both all this stuff, right? But the fact that it's developing, people recognize this relationship, our relationship, absolutely, by person. And often marketing is
$300 suggested donation. So, I mean,
can't think of anything. Unless we're changing the content. And you know, and you see the, I mean, the programming really reflects the community in a way, right? And for whatever reason, like, we've gotten a lot of, after 35 years, right? Like, that program is, like, good. Like, no one's stressing out about Southern Brooklyn and making it more accessible. But, like, that took 35 years. But, you know, Brick House, which is a building we opened in October, and I would say it's already fairly successful. Most of our tickets are under $23. And our doors are always open. We have like a cafe and a stoop that's free and accessible to the public. And that's good. And we're like up to our necks with like stressing out about how much the program is, like what we should do. But so with I think with all of that, I think about like what is our responsibility to our surrounding community. And for the most part, again, our programming is reflective. Ron Brown is like a huge coup for us in terms of like his work is so driven in terms of being sort of based in the community. I mean, he's worked with people so and like community center, which is like a branch of University Settlement, and he had dance workshops within EagleSoul and half the inauguration at EagleSoul with dancers and a lot of those. Perform in this show. And so there is that component. And at the same time, you know, I think there's still this fear of failure in terms of money, right? I feel like funders and board members with all due respect tend not to be a diverse group of different socioeconomic levels, right? They tend to come from a place with money, which is why they are on your board, right? But then, and this is me talking. This is not Rick talking. Maybe I'm just thinking. I have the sense that there's an economic disparity, right? Like the things that they're like really excited about may not be the thing that like you know folks living in Fort Greene are excited about, and but they have the leverage, right? They can say like if a funder wants to like I have $1 million to make this project happen, like do you say no to that? You know. Right. Or like, but like you could use the money, you know what I'm saying? It's like you could really use that extra million to like pay some folks and then give raises, whatever. But like, you know, like I feel like there is a tension, I mean, between that and, you know, like.
There's a lot of educating our funders.
Yeah.
There's a lot, you know, I think. Yeah.
And well, and you know what? I don't have a board. I mean, I haven't made a board yet. And it's, yeah. I've gotten work in between. And I've never owed anybody any money in 10 years. So it's also possible, I mean, there's lots of problematics with that. Yes. I mean, I have a board, legal board, for tape and. I have a board and a secretary. but I tried it for about 2 years, and it took so much time, and people always felt like we were failing, and it just wasn't working. And so I said, okay, the Worcester group doesn't know.
Well, I want to sort of ping-pong on that, back to the idea of the work itself. Because obviously the funding and the work itself, and regional theaters, small independent theaters, independent artists, it's all this vast and interconnected ecosystem. I think that's one of the things that is the interdependency of the system. And because, you know, these are placed in competition, we are disincentivized from collaborating meaningfully and from sharing. sharing resources. You know, the and there is a whole in the, you know, book of common report, we go into great detail about sort of why the 501c3 and the Catholic structures in place, and why funding must go through these sort of elaborate, difficult mechanisms that almost, you know, we have to preclude smaller, more nimble, more agile organizations from access to that capital. But I want to sort of think about that in relationship to really actually what you're doing with the Public Journal of Men in America and my own self-interest in discourse.
Yeah.
Because I feel that like the one of the big problems is language.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, you articulated very well sort of that different artistic communities are facing different challenges and how they talk about the work and how they talk to each other about the work. And then we have real problems talking to each other across the work. For instance, from the, I can imagine from the perspective of a large regional theater, it's hard to imagine how they would work with the same sort of highway names. You know, and I've heard story of places all the time they're trying to work, but they don't have, you know, large institutional theaters that want to work with smaller ensemble or, you know, more agile people. Think that they don't know how to negotiate their own infrastructure, and then we have been able to build a public conversation that both empowers artists, all the stakeholders, to have a real conversation about how do we talk about the work, how do we talk about risk, how do we talk about success versus failure, what are those means? And so I want to talk back about and just sort of, if you want to talk a little bit about because you've been working in the writing, contextualizing and articulating about this for a long time, and also the public, tell a little bit about that to it.
Well, this is it's a pretty new food journal. There's one issue that you can log on to public.imagineamerica.org. There's an organization called Imagine America Artisan Scholars and Public Scholars. And so check it out. I mean, I also want, you know, Andy used the D-word discourse, just because I'm listening to this and I'm thinking the same thing. And where are all the different places where conversations have to happen as well as the work? You know, we need both. And but where? What are the entryways? So obviously the internet and its open access, that's good. You know, I wish that there were someone who wrote about the kind of performance we've been talking about for the New York Times. But I'm an alternative gal, so it's not like I would put all my eggs in that basket even if I could. And so, like, just because there was, like, there was this great paradigm that a mathematician came up with. It's how do paradigms change? It's a famous book. Someone will think of it, the name, maybe it's me or someone else. But basically, it's about how scientific paradigms change. It's so nice to look at things one way. What allows it to change? And the example that the writer is given is he's showing cards very quickly. You have to say, like, red of hearts, two of spades, three of clubs. But some of the clubs are red and some of the diamonds are black. And people are getting terribly confused and upset. They can't bring themselves to see a red club. And they don't know what to call it, just because there's no language for it. Even though they see it with their own eyes, there's the evidence. So what is it that allows us to see differently? I mean, I couldn't agree with you more about how we measure differently. We have such a terrible habit of somewhat monolithic ways of measuring, and yet listening to the work, seeing the work, we know there's any number of things that are valuable for us. So that's what I'd say.
I think one of the most important sites of this conversation is between artists.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you know, over 20 years, like, the family pretty much makes almost everything by commission. And the initial conversations that we have with people, they don't, artists, there are many artists who resist having agency, knowing how to write a budget, knowing, thinking about the nature of the invitation to the work. And, I mean, somebody said to me 10 years ago, somebody from the social justice sector said, oh, you're an artist organizer. And I said, oh yeah, well, not really. But it's very hard, I think, for because it, the structure of how people have to make a living is so backwards in terms of thinking about the future of theater. I mean, the market is sort of less than fair. Market that we live in is it's pretty choking, and so the family doesn't like to, we don't deal with agents until we absolutely have to, and right away a lot of artists are like, I'm not comfortable there, so that's cool, then they don't, we don't like to deal with agents, although sometimes we're stuck doing that. We try really hard to make the budgets of every show with the artists who are coming. Lots of times they're not so interested. You know, I mean, and again, this is not a blame thing. This is a systemic thing. And so I feel like why the Brooklyn Commune is so important and why I have been running the family for 20 years is because what are the territories upon which artists can come together to find their own sense of agency and recognize the real importance of that agency in change and making a world that we live in.
So true. I get back to the whole thing. I mean, for an artist to come into an institution and really kind of force me to see things from a perspective, not force, not bad, but that's what, right, that's what's important. And luckily we're small enough and flexible enough and young enough that like we're a little more pliable and the game switching up and different things. But it's, I think whenever possible, I think it is, you know, to fortify the artist's voice and make sure that they are in ongoing conversations. And another thing I was gonna say is when possible, and I am praying for the day that, you know, sort of selfishly that don't do our own marketing press, but we do and always have done, which means that we work very closely. Like, we don't hire an outside house person to do it, which I think that's when we get in trouble. Potentially with losing a little bit of, like, things start to, you know, labels start to get slapped on things and whatever. But if you're working really hand in hand with the artist about language and imagery and marketing from in house, I think that that's, you know, I think you can, it's great. I, of course, like I said, it's double edged sword.
I mean, that's something to say here, I feel like, is important in terms of thinking about the future and thinking about the incredible ecology of all of this and measurement is we can't, not one of our forward moving entities can do everything. We can do, like, I don't have a board, okay? So I don't have that fundraising possibility. I have limited, I have enough money to do what I do and to pay people well in doing it. But it means that I can't do many, many things that I wish I could do. Many, many. But you know what? Other people are doing that. You know what I mean? So, like, I can say, okay, well, I have enough to do these six things. Damn it, I had 80 more I wanted to do. And the detail, and like the idea of invitation, I'm sorry to go back to this, I don't understand it, so I'm always reaching for its understanding. I tried to teach a course for La Mama to a bunch of directors about where does the stage begin? Like, how is invitation good? It was a terrible course, I couldn't do it. But the idea of, well, these only six things that I can do are massive when you think about the extension of the stage and how people are, and like where does the invitation starts the piece, the making of the piece starts the piece, the invitation starts the invitation, the, you know, it's like every single tiny bit contains the whole thing, and that's the details, and that's doing it in-house, and that, you know, the minute you start to, I totally get it, are you kidding? Please, somebody else do this. But when you start, you have to do that so, so carefully.
All right, I really carefully have to pop in here because we're at time and some people are already going to go see your back show. So I just wanted to do a quick housekeeping. One, thank you all, everybody, for being here.
giving the artists like total, giving the keys to the house of the crazy people, because like he's the greatest example of just listening to the artists and making shit happen. And I, if you ever want to know how to do it right, just talk to Mark or look at his history. And the third thing is, if you want to keep this conversation going, a bunch of us from the Brooklyn Commune are going to the Invisible Dog. We're going to be there from 3 o'clock till like 5 or 6, hanging out. And we hope you'll join us there. So thank you, Andrew Bayard. Thank you, everybody. And enjoy your Wednesday week.